In nomine Patris et Filii et Spiritus Sancti. Ave Maria, gratia plena, Dominus tecum, benedicta tu in mulieribus, et benedictus fructus ventris tui, Iesus. Sancta Maria, Mater Dei, ora pro nobis peccatoribus, nunc in hora mortis nostrae. Amen. Sedes sapientiae. In nomine Patris et Filii et Spiritus Sancti. My plan then for today's class is to cover the second part of, as we know, a 12-section Apostles' Creed. Let's say it together. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. Enough. And in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. As we know, there is more to both the life of Christ, his passion, death, resurrection, ascension into heaven, and his governing the world from the right hand of his heavenly Father, all of which are part of the Apostles' Creed. Our concentration is on the Incarnation. Now, the notes that I've shared with you, hope you can read, they are somewhat abbreviated and not always fully legible. They are part of the spiritual exercises of, as you know, St. Ignatius. And the foundation of what is called the second week of the exercises is the Incarnation. At any rate, I thought I would share this outline with you to give us the context within which we would speak on the Incarnation. There are three basic questions that we will ask ourselves and the hour plus that we have try to answer. What is the Incarnation? Why did God become man? And how are we to live this mystery? Those, by the way, are the three fundamental questions of human existence. The what, the why, and the how. In other words, first to know what God has revealed here, his Incarnation. Then why did God become man? And then, on a very down-to-earth level, how are we to put this mystery of our faith into practice? We begin then by asking ourselves, what is the Incarnation? Let me tell you, even though, as I found through various over 40 years of teaching, what a difference between two people, both of whom hear the same words, can memorize the same definitions made by the church. And over the years, when you question them or examine them, will give the right answers. But what a difference between knowing something here, a mystery of the faith, and understanding that mystery. When then we ask, what is the incarnation? We're asking ourselves, what do we understand by God's becoming man? And this is, I trust, we all appreciate, is our principal responsibility in life. Our most basic duty as Christians is to understand what we believe. Even I use these words, I say to myself, well, I've said them by now to maybe 100 audiences. You'll take notes. I'll examine them. And years later, many of my own Jesuit students will write books, shake my head. What a difference between really grasping the inner meaning of a mystery of faith. And as we casually and without a second thought say, knowing it. What then is the incarnation? Literally, it means the Word was made flesh. The most, in one sense, condensed, from another perspective, the most profound analysis of the incarnation is found in the first chapter of St. John's Gospel, where John first describes the Holy Trinity and the second person, the Word of God. Finally, by the 14th verse, he tells us, and the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. Literally, as we know, incarnation means the enfleshment of the second person. Caro in Latin means flesh. The noun corresponding to the noun caro is incarnare, to enflesh. God then took on human flesh. Even as we begin today's lecture, you will be the only one directly on this profound subject that will spend, please God, all of eternity fathoming its implications. The most important thing we should all know is that when God became man, he took on a material, quantified, extended flesh, body, bone, blood. In other words, whatever else the incarnation means, and it means 1,000 more things, it means fundamentally that God, who is pure spirit, took on matter. And by contrast, I think we covered some of this, didn't we, in last class? If this was a class in Jesuits, I never began a class teaching Jesuits, never, with a lecture. The first 15 or 20 minutes, always, always quizzing the class. You're being spared. Who can finish the sentence? The capacity of the human mind to forget is
infinite.
Thank you. At least you didn't forget that. God, we say, is pure spirit. And by pure spirit, we mean having nothing material. Matter, in contrast with spirit, matter is weighable. Matter has size, shape, extension. Matter, as we say, is quantified. You count, you measure matter, and you begin to realize how thoroughly, how deeply, how universally materialized our society is. We count and we measure and we weigh everything. Whereas from all eternity, a being existed who by definition has no weight, no size, no quantity. God then took on matter in becoming incarnate. Secondly, God became man. When we say that, however, let's be clear. Over the years, in the 2 semester courses I've taught in Christology, these are the men whom I had in class. No one did I ever have in class who did not have a graduate degree, ever. And yet we spend 3 hours a week, 15 weeks a semester, and 2 semesters. And after 2 semesters, we would just begin to scratch the surface of what we call technically Christology, which is the science of the incarnation. God became man. The moment we use a verb like became regarding God, you shiver. We should feel guilty in even using the word became regarding God, becoming anything. The God who existed from all eternity, the God except for whom nothing else would exist, including my lips and your ears. This God became what he had not been before. And what a becoming that was. He became one of his own creatures. God had to create the humanity, which he then, what verb shall we use, began to inhabit. One word, or more appropriately, that the humanity of Christ became what? What happened to the incarnation? We speak of Christ's humanity. We dealt with this, I remember, last class. Who can remember? the human nature of Christ was how, what did the Holy Trinity or the Holy Spirit do to make the incarnation possible? Did I hear something? Please?
Overshadow.
Oh, that's good. A little more concrete. We speak of Jesus being the Messiah, don't we? And Messiah in the Greek is Christos. And Christos means in English what?
Anointed.
Please?
Anointed.
So, does anybody remember that we said Christ's humanity was anointed by the divinity? So the incarnation was the anointing of Christ's human nature, or better, the human nature of a man was anointed with a divinity. Not merely given powers, but literally that man, Jesus of Nazareth, whom his contemporaries in Palestine knew as a man, was anointed with, not to repeat, was anointed with what?
Divinity.
With the? Say it.
Divinity.
Great. It takes courage sometimes to say certain things. And you know why? Oh, how well I know. I've sat for too many years in too many classrooms. What it takes is humility. We're scared. Scared of being wrong. So the incarnation is the anointing of the human nature of a man, because Christ did not just become generic humanity. He became a specific man. And again, what is the incarnation? The infinite God became a finite being. Over the years, I have come to define the incarnation as the humiliation of God. God could not have become less or have more demeaned himself than by becoming a man. God could not have become an animal. That would have been blasphemy. The lowest rational creature in the world is a human being. Angels are much superior to us. As St. Paul, remember, goes out of his way to bring out that God bypassed the angels and became a man. And finally, everything we can say about God, we can attribute to Jesus Christ. By the way, these less than one line statements were years in the making, believe me. Among my unpublished books is about a 450-page manuscript, 450 pages, single-spaced, in Christology. There is just an ocean of revealed wisdom taught by the Church. In fact, there is no single truth of the Catholic faith taught over the centuries by who knows, by how many general councils of the Catholic Church have been held. Look, if you make a mistake, you're humiliated. If you know, you practice charity. The last General Council, Second Vatican, how many was that?
Two.
How many?
Two. Two
was the second. Yeah. In other words, in the history of the General Councils, Second Vatican Council is which?
20.
How many?
20.
20 what?
21.
Somebody say 21? Okay. You never know what you're going to hear in class. From 325, the Council of Nicaea, to Second Vatican in the 20th century, there is no single truth of the Catholic faith on which more councils have said more than on who is Jesus Christ. And the reason, of course, is because everything, and the word is everything, depends on who Christ is. In any case, so far, number one, what is the Incarnation? Next question, why? Why did God become man? Or in other words, why the Incarnation? And as I've said at the beginning, and I'm just repeating now, this is basic to our spiritual life. To really grasp the reason for God's becoming man is to understand what the spiritual life is all about. We go on. There are two fundamental reasons. So that God could die for our salvation. Why did God become man? God became man because God is God, could not die. And so what did he do? He became man, indeed a mortal man. Why? In order that by his death, he might redeem a sinful world. Even as I say this, and then go on, well, to the next section, I feel guilty because I know how well I know, beginning with myself, how shallow is our grasp of what we are saying when we say the first and fundamental reason why God became man was that I might be able to die in order to redeem us from sin and its consequences. As my confrere, St. Robert Bellarmine, in his conferences to his own fellow Jesuits, told them, if ever you have any doubt about the seriousness of sin, remind yourselves, sin must be terrible. If God had to become man and die on the cross to redeem us from sin and its effects. I do on occasion look at the daily newspaper, but not daily. For me, it's a necessary mortification. The daily papers are mainly journals of sin. And afterwards, we become, I don't say so accustomed, but so, I want to say, hypnotized by the prevalence, the extent, the depth of sin that, as we know, novelists and those who write the scenarios for our television programs and movie producers look around, what can be still more startling? People are so accustomed to sin. All I can do is either spend more time on the subject or raise my voice or get up on a box or a stand to make an impression. But, and this needs to be said, not every human being on earth today will be in heaven in eternity. Do you hear me? There is a hell. There are consequences to sin. And God became man, first reason, to save us from the consequences of sin. Second reason, so that God could live among us. In other words, and we ask, why did God become man? The first reason is the redemption. And the second is God's love for us. God became man so that he could be with us, among us, as man. We go on. Why did God become man? First, to be able to die for us. So, he became man with a body and a soul. Did God have to become man with a body and a soul? Yes. Why? Because if God had not assumed both a body and a soul, then he could not have been able to die. Question. when God became man in the person of Christ, was Christ mortal or immortal? Michael?
Immortal.
He was?
Immortal.
He was immortal. Well, if Christ was immortal, then how could he die? Seems to me, you've got to make a choice. Either he was immortal and could not die,
was it because of his hypostatic union with the divine person?
Well, by the way, did you follow my question?
No.
Well, look, let's take a vote. Notice my question. When Christ came into the world, say, when he was born in Bethlehem, the child in Mary's arms on Christmas morning, was Jesus mortal or immortal? Question first. How many believe that Jesus in Mary's arms was mortal? Thanks. Next question. How many believe that Jesus was immortal? Strange. You're both right. I'm not exaggerating. We could spend 1 hour on every word in this one page and just begin to analyze the subject. As a man, Christ would have been mortal. As a man. Because human nature is naturally mortal. Our first parents, when they were first made by God. Question. See, I'm presuming so much. When our first parents came from the hands of God, when our first parents came from the hands of God, were they immortal or mortal, Paul?
Immortal.
I asked Paul.
Immortal.
Please?
Immortal.
Okay. Now, were they naturally immortal?
Yes.
Well, they had the gifts of immortality from God.
So it was a gift. They were not naturally. Naturally, no one is. Naturally, no one is immortal in body. Naturally, it's a gift. They lost that gift by their sin. And we come into the world, as Augustine says, we come into the world dying. The moment we're conceived, we begin to die. Back to Christ. Naturally then, Christ would have been mortal. However, being sinless, Christ then enjoyed the gift that our first parents enjoyed. Who else besides Christ enjoyed the gift of bodily immortality?
Mary.
His mother. Okay? So that we would use the term, he would have been naturally mortal, but preternaturally, and of course, being God, he made the decision that he, though, now watch this, he was then preternaturally immortal. So then how could he die? He sacrificed. And does this ever have to be brought out? And the whole, not just a litany, but a library of spiritual implications follows that Christ, though not being a sinner, and absolutely, utterly exempt from the consequences of sin that all of us must experience. Christ, who had the privilege of not paying the debt of sin in order to be able to redeem us, he then chose, to be mortal, okay? He chose, in other words, to be able to die, even though by all the credit of his glorified human nature, he was not to have died. Okay. He became man, therefore, with his body and soul, in order that his body and soul might separate and thus cause his death. Again, he took on a human free will to be able to sacrifice for us. God became man, therefore, for two profound reasons. First profound reason, that he might be able to die. And talk about choosing death. Notice, Christ chose death twice over. He chose death first by choosing to become man. But then, being the sinless Son of God, he would not have been subject to death. So then he chose, we say in theology, he worked the miracle. He worked the miracle of subjecting himself to bodily death, which he did not have to undergo. And that, my dear friends, is the rock bottom of the spiritual life. Out of love for Christ, you choose what you don't have to. Am I clear? And you choose what is difficult. Out of love for him, even as he, out of love for us, chose death. And once you say that, he chose all the implications of death. I want to spend another minute or two on this, because this is, as I said, this is it. This is the circumference of the spiritual life. You never ask, must I do it? Will I sin if I don't do it? Can you imagine Christ asking, do I have to become man? That's blasphemy, my Lord. And having become man, Do I have to suffer and die? That's nonsense. But, and this is where we all have, and the younger, and some, like present company, the older, have still a lot to learn. And there's one thing you learn, or better, one thing you should learn. The longer the Lord keeps you in this world, you should learn the precious, sweet, dear love of the cross. In one single declarative sentence, that's what the love of Christ is all about. In other words, God, out of love for us, and it is sheer love, no question of constriction or compulsion or necessity of any kind, you dare not, without committing a grave sin of blasphemy, you never speak of God having to do anything. Am I clear? He is God. But he chose to become man. And then he chose, and the two things that are bedrock to our understanding of what we call Christology. He chose to have a body and a soul that could separate by death. And he chose to be able to choose to die. In other words, he chose to have a free will. And that's what he gave us. And the longer I live, the more people I deal with, by noon of any day, I've already seen human self-will manifested, sometimes traumatically. Ooh, the will, that self-will. To let go of it, always, according to the will of God. All of this is locked up in, well, why did God become man? May I ask what the time is? I don't have a clock.
1:45.
Please?
1:45.
1:45. Well, I think, unless I'm mistaken, we go to around 2 something, 15 or so, 20, then we get a break. Okay, I'm safe. Then see in your church, and ask you the why. Why did God become man? To be able to live for us in these ways. First, on earth before his resurrection. And most of his preaching, as we know, most of the miracles he worked he both spoke and performed for his death and resurrection. Then, still on earth, what he taught and did during the 40 days after his resurrection. Who would know the two great gifts of the risen Christ from Easter Sunday to Ascension Thursday? What are the two great gifts that Jesus gave us?
The sacrament of confession.
The sacrament of confession. Is that ever a gift? And the well, that was I mean, she'd already had the Last Supper. On the shore of the lake, after the apostles, fishermen, had fished all night. And remember, they caught nothing. Good for them. Then who remembers? How many fish did they catch?
153.
Don't forget that. 153. Then after catching those fish and having eaten heartily, then what did Christ do? Okay, he gave Peter the primacy, having promised that he would be the rock on whom he would build his church in the 16th chapter of Matthew's gospel. Who remembers what chapter of which gospel does Jesus confer the primacy on Peter? Silence. Over the years in teaching in Protestant seminaries, by the way, students always, just a matter of policy, always came with a copy of the Bible. And they really knew their Bible. So, once more, what gospel? What gospel? Who said?
John.
And what chapter? Which chapter?
21st.
21st. First. Okay. Thank you. The two great gifts of the risen Savior, the sacrament of confession and the papal primacy. We go on. Then in heaven, after his ascension, Christ has become our priest, interceding for us at the right hand of his heavenly Father. That is why he is there. And remember, Christ is in heaven in the fullness of both his divinity and humanity. Then on earth, Christ is on earth in the Holy Eucharist. He is on earth in the sacrament, remember? The sacrament of the sacrifice of the Mass, the sacrament of Holy Communion, and the sacrament of Christ's real presence. I think I should share this with you and ask that you say a prayer. I gave two talks yesterday in Sioux City, Iowa. I arrived about 10:30 at night, Friday. Stayed overnight adoratory in one state. It was in South Dakota. Then, in the morning, a pastor drove me from South Dakota to Iowa, where I gave my talks. And the church where I spoke, you never in your wildest dreams think this was a Catholic church. No statues, no holy pictures, no nothing, except three red pillars. The Blessed Sacrament in another room outside the church. I should say, they took up a collection and, of course, I paid my respects to our Lord in the Holy Eucharist. Lord, I may never again in my life be in that church, but I'm sure going to do something. I'm doing it right now. To bring Christ back into our churches. That's why he's on earth. And of course, he remains in heaven after the last day, in what I call the Eucharist unveiled, when we shall see him as he is, not only as we hope we shall, our souls in vision, beholding as we believe the face of God, but our bodies, bodily eyes, seeing the Son of Mary, and he seeing us. Question: does Christ in the Holy Eucharist have his human body?
Yes.
Does he?
Yes.
Does he have a pair of human eyes?
Yes.
Does he see us?
Yes.
Does he hear us? And on occasion, if you're especially holy, you can also hear him. How we need for many people to recover our faith in the real presence, and therefore what I've done at the bottom to live this mystery. With faith, gratitude for the past, present, and the future. God might have become man and left us only the pleasant memory of his having lived and died on earth. But no, he wanted to remain with us. And the Eucharist, let me repeat, the Eucharist is not just a symbolic anticipation of our own resurrection from the dead. It is the guarantee, and that is why, and I'll share this with you, over the years, and I'm confident I'm talking to the right audience, I've encouraged Catholics to receive communion during the week. Father, you don't know my schedule. I tell them, and you don't know mine. But on a very pragmatic level, what is the promise that Christ made in the 6th chapter of John's Gospel, that if we receive his body and drink his blood, what's the promise? Raises up on the last day. Pardon me for putting it this way. How dumb can we be? We're all going to die. And then, what a mild verb. We're going to decay, otherwise known as we're going to rot. All the obnoxious odor of life, the masters of the spiritual life tell us, are to be a reminder of what's going to happen to our bodies. They're going to rot. And then, only God knows how long a delay. But faith tells us we have the promise of our resurrection from the dead, provided we receive him. So to repeat, pardon me for the Anglo-Saxon, let's not be dumb. You want to rise from the dead. What a question. Of course. Well then, my friend, how about taking the proper means of ensuring that you will rise from the dead? And if even one person, I've said this over the years, if one person in the audience that I address would start going to Mass and communion during the week, more than worth my while to strongly encourage you. Somebody told me that a priest told her that this second communion on the same day, the Mass, second Mass, has to be for some special occasion. Nonsense. That's spelled N-O-N-S-E-N-S-E. Nonsense. So in other words, get a Mass and communion at least once a day. Okay? I'll spare you. I won't ask for a raising of hands. Christ is here that we might receive him and thus ensure our own bodily resurrection from the dead. And now, we are asking how we are to live the mystery of what we believe, and to syncopate an ocean of theology I have with love for the past, present, and the future. I wouldn't be fair with you as we're going through the second article of the Creed. I did not recommend meditating on the Gospels, especially on Christ's life on earth. A good practice is to take the Gospel for the day, which is generally, except of course, during certain seasons of the year, but generally of the 365 days in the year, most of the gospel passages are from Christ's, well, life on earth, independent, say, of his passion. But his passion, too, daily spends some time meditating on Christ's life, passion, death, and resurrection. And then finally, with love for Christ, and then didn't quite come out. I tried to underline three words. This is Christ, and I underline the word Christ. Second sentence, I underline the word is, and third, I underline the word earth. Earth. Christ is on earth. Christ is on earth. This is, as I trust, your faith and mine. All I can tell you is, the more I deal with souls, the more in contact I am with persons who need to have a strong foundation in their lives, especially those whose lives are tried and difficult and demanding. Though I spoke from today to the 9th of October next year, 8 hours a day, I would not be talking too much about how indispensable is Jesus Christ in our lives. In other words, to see everything in our lives from his perspective, to see him in everything. It is now 18 years that I've been teaching Mother Teresa's Missionaries of Charity. And over these years, I've been especially struck, as most of you I think know, every chapel in the world that they have. I've been now in 11 countries. Under the right arm of the cross is the inscription, I thirst. As we know, that was one of the seven last words of our Lord before he died. And by now, there are 1,000 meanings of the spiritual masters have attached to the Latin sitio, in English, I thirst. But the one meaning that is especially pertinent to us. God became man because he thirsts for our love. In sacred scripture, there are two verbs that express the extreme of human desire. and they are hunger and thirst. In the language of theology, the hunger expresses the need we all have to know the truth. The deepest hunger of the human soul is for the truth. And our nation, the most educated in human history, an average of 5 million plus every year in colleges and universities in America, but starving for the truth. After my 5-year stay at Western Michigan, and I could have written 10 books about my students, I settled for one book. Matures out of hundreds of term papers they wrote me. The longest term papers I received in 40 years of teaching, I received from my undergraduate students at Western Michigan, pouring out their souls. And I call the book, which could have been a series, The Hungry Generation. I could just as well have called it The Starving Generation. America is starving for the truth. And the other verb, their hunger in biblical language stands for the deep, ravenous desire for the truth. The mind needs to be fed the truth. Thirst, in the language of the Bible, symbolizes the correspondingly strong, deathless desire of the will for love. And Christ then said, I thirst. He became man to be able to use the word, I thirst, intelligibly. But he used that term as God, because what God mainly wants from us, not because he needs it, but we need it. He wants our love because he knows the deepest need of our heart is to love the God from whom we came and except for whom our heart can never be satisfied. And this is what our faith in the Holy Eucharist is all about. Just one closing word. There are so many authors who have written extensively both about Christ and about the Holy Eucharist. I know of no single writer who has written more either profoundly or more appealingly about both Jesus Christ and the Holy Eucharist, then guess who? Saint Alphonsus Liguori. I hereby recommend his writings to all of you. Alphonsus Liguori is one of three minds that have mainly shaped this mind, along with, of course, Saint Ignatius, and surprisingly, Saint Francis of Assisi. My mother, I told you, was a Franciscan tertiary. Before I could read, she would read to me from the, remember the little flowers of Saint Francis? Alphonsus Liguori brings out what so desperately needs to be known today. Jesus Christ is on earth. He is present, but he wants us to be present too. We are always on his mind, always in his heart. He wants us to have him always on our minds and in our hearts. Amen. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. How are we doing on the time? 2:20? Okay. 2:15, eh? Okay. So, let's say a prayer now. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. O Mary, conceived without sin. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen.